When we heard word from Darrell that his flight was going to keep him from being here first slot, we said, we're going to shuffle things around a little bit. Kind of felt like a manager getting the lineup just right. So he saw he was batting leadoff, and he felt like he was a cleanup hitter, I guess. So we decided to slide him down. See, as much baseball analogy as I'll use, he can use more if he wants. I'm more excited about him as an individual, as a man who's been seeking truth throughout his life. You know, that was going to be our leadoff talk, and he's going to bring it in a lot of different ways about seeking the faith, and just saying, Lord, where is it you want me to be? Most important thing to me, and he'll probably say it, I'm stealing his material. I couldn't find him for just a second. I was panicked. I thought, where'd he go? Cold feet? I got to do this myself. He had called his wife, asked her to pray with him before he talked. That is huge. That's the kind of heart that is going to come to speak to you right now. Let's welcome Darrell Miller.
Testing 1, 2, are we on? Can you hear me? Hello? Gentlemen, how are you? You guys have heard some great speakers. I am Darrell Miller. I'm a former ball player. I played baseball for the California Angels. A lot of you guys aren't old enough to remember the California Angels. Actually, I got to share real quick. I was just, my wife had called. She goes, oh, I just missed praying with you. So I called her back, and I kept losing her up here, so I had to walk out. And this is how my wife started the prayer. She goes, God, I just want to thank you for Darrell and what a great wife that he has. Honest engine. So she's hilarious. She really is a funny girl. But she's the reason I became Catholic, and it really wasn't the reason. I mean, she wasn't the reason I became Catholic, because I was trying to get her out of the Catholic Church. But she was so strong of a Catholic. I'm sorry, my inflections are going all up and down. I had never seen anyone that was unmovable in their Catholic faith. And anyone else I had ever met, I'd been able to, convince. It's a bad deal that I'm last, wasn't Gus unbelievable? I mean, Gus was such a great speaker. Father, when I arrived, Father, what's his, starts with an L, he was really good. Lasante, he was really good too. So this is a little bit like my career. So, and I don't know, you guys probably followed my career very closely. I know you always all know I am. But I promise you, this follows my career, and I'm coming up against, after some really heavy hitters. I was called up to the big leagues in 1984 to play first base for the California Angels, and I had never played first base. I mean, I played maybe 10 games in instructional league 2 years before, and I'll never forget, Moose Steubing was our manager, and he says, Darrell, I got good news and bad news for you. And I was doing really good in AAA, and I was thinking, well, maybe I'm going to get called up to the big leagues. You're going to get called up to the big leagues, son. He's from New York, so he had this really strong Bronx accent. I got good news and I got bad news for you, sons. Everything has an S on it. I go, what's the good news, Moose? Well, you're going to the big leagues, sons. You're going to play in the big leagues. Congratulations. You're the best I got. He didn't say you earned it or, I can't wait for you to get to the big leagues. You're going to take him over the top. I'm the best that he had. And then I go, well, what's the bad news, Moose? He goes, well, you're going to play first base. I said, Moose, I can't play first base. I don't have a first baseman's glove. Well, I'm a catcher. I play a little outfield, but I can't play first. I don't have a glove. You'll be fine. You'll be okay. Go ask somebody. Somebody up there has got to have a first baseman glove. And sure enough, I'm called up to play first base, and I had to replace Rod Carew at first base. So, now batting, not Rod Carew, Darrell Miller. Strike one, strike two. What's a curveball? Strike three. No, I wasn't that bad, almost that bad. 4 or 5 pitches, not 3 pitches. And then so in 1985, You know, I had the luxury of being this guy named, you guys probably haven't heard of this guy, but we had a right fielder that was pretty good too, who's also in the Hall of Fame, named Reggie Jackson. So I replaced Reggie Jackson in right field. And Reggie was so kind about it because he, you know, he really relished the thought of not being a good defender, if you guys remember Reggie at all. So I remember he wore the helmet in the outfield for good reason. So I replaced Reggie in the outfield in 85. And then this other guy that wasn't very good either, you guys may remember him. His name is Bob Boone. I caught behind Bob Boone the rest of my career. So those are my guys. Those are the guys that I had to follow. So, you know, I'm following good company again because I thought Gus did a great job. He was fantastic. Well, the reason I am here is because somehow I got tricked into becoming Catholic by this girl that just prayed with me. But more importantly, I value you enough to leave my family on a Saturday morning and miss a Little League game and miss my son's high school baseball game and my daughter's soccer game. I value my Lord and Savior enough to spend that time with you. And I really mean that because there's nothing more important than the gospel of Jesus Christ in my life and what he's done for me. So. You know, Gus said our story is relevant and it's important, and everyone has a story. And the gospel is really about the story of how God so loved us. And all of us have a story that relates to how God loved us enough to where we wanted to change or we wanted to respond. And so my response was when I was 15 years old, I grew up in a, you know, pretty athletic home. I mean, we were decent athletes. My little sister, Cheryl Miller, who's an 8-time All-American basketball player. And, you know, my littler brother is Reggie Miller, and he was played about 16 years with the Indiana Pacers. And my older brother was probably the best athlete in the family. His name's Saul, and he was in the Airmen of Note for 30 years as an accomplished saxophonist. And my youngest tiny sister named Tammy, who's 6 foot tall, was an All-American volleyball player at Cal State Fullerton. So I was only a lousy, you know, All-American at Cal Poly Pomona State University, you know, catcher, and signed in 79. And my dad wanted us to, you know, get our education through athletics, because he was an enlisted man in the Air Force. We moved all around the United States. We were at Minot, off at North Dakota. Minot, North Dakota, off at Air Force Base in Nebraska. Marsh Air Force Base out in Riverside, yeah, two tours of duty out there. I was born in Washington, D.C., Walter Reed Army Hospital, and we were in Virginia for a while as well, so we kind of moved all over the place. So growing up in an Air Force home, okay, can I move or am I just stuck? Growing up in an Air Force home was very difficult because we got to change friends every 3 years. And I remember vividly every 3 years, you know, everybody crying, oh, see you, I'll write you, I'll talk to you, I promise I'll call you. You know, you never called anybody, you know, you're 10 years old, who are you gonna call, you know? Can't find anybody. And my dad, I remember every single year, or every 3 years, my mom or my dad would go, you know what? And we'd be crying, don't worry about it, you'll be fine. If you didn't like who you were in this neighborhood, just reinvent yourself, you know? We'd go, okay. Be better, you know. Okay, great. Well, I remember being invited to receive Christ in my heart. My family was Baptist. And I remember walking down the aisle when I was 15 years old and asking Christ to come into my heart. And I remember just crying and turning in front of the audience and crying, and everyone, you know, two or three other people came. And then the next Sunday, you know, they gave this invitation to receive Christ in your heart. I came down all the way front again. And then the next Sunday, I came down again. And so the fourth Sunday when I went down front again, you know, my mom was really embarrassed. I didn't know that, you know, until I got back to the pew. And she goes, why do you keep going up front? You know, everyone knows that you received Christ. I go, you know what? Every Sunday, I just want to receive Christ in my heart. I just really want him to know that I mean it. And that was the reason I became Catholic about 30 years later, or 25 years later. I just didn't know why I wanted to receive Christ every single Sunday. I just didn't understand why my heart kept asking for him, for his presence in my life. Because that's what we do, you know. Well, you know that when we go forward and we receive the Eucharist, we receive Christ, and we ask him to be Lord of our lives every single time that we receive the Eucharist. We are surrendering our hearts and our souls and our bodies completely to Christ so that he would now indwell in us and be God in us and change us on the inside so that we would now be the body of Christ to everyone else. Did you know that? Every single time we go forward, we receive Christ, and then we surrender our hearts. So you're born again every single Sunday. But I met this girl, okay, this one I just prayed with. And I'll never forget, I got a call in AAA right before Moose called, said you're going to go to the big leagues, and actually about a month before. And my friend's name was Gary Pettis, and he was my roommate in pro ball. And he called me, he goes, hey, I just met this girl you're going to love. Oh, my God, she's beautiful. She's so smart. Oh, good. You got to get up here to the big leagues. I go, look, I'm hitting 345. I don't know what else to do. You know, hey, what can I do? We're loaded. We got Bobby Gritch, and we got Fred Lynn. We got you. We got Brian Downing and Doug DeCenses and Rick Burleson and, you know, Rod Carew and Bob Boone and Reggie Jackson, and, you know, who am I better than? He goes, I don't know, just get up here, man, because she's pretty. You're going to love her. I go, all right, whatever. So I get lucky enough to get called up, and then, you know, a couple months later, you know, somehow we get introduced, and I go, wow, you know, she was such a nice girl. I go, wow, I'm so glad are you a Christian, you know, and, you know, do you know Christ as your Savior? She goes, oh, no, I don't, but I'm Catholic, you know. I don't, you know, I'm Catholic and I really love God, but I don't know what you're talking about. I just know that, you know, I'm Catholic. And I go, wow. Dang it, God. Why me? Why her? What's going on? I mean, she's so pretty and she's so awesome. She's got such a great spirit, but she's lost. She's going to hell. She's Catholic, for goodness sake. We all know all Catholics are not going to heaven. You know that. I know that. The Catholics are the ones that steal our quarterbacks in high school. The Catholics are the ones that drink everyone else under the table. Come on. So I tried to get her out. I tried to get her to these athlete outreaches and non-denominational churches, and we're going all over the place. And we'd always have to go to Mass every Sunday and then, you know, non-denominational church. She would not give up. So I finally started trying to challenge her on what she believed and what she didn't believe. And I got her cousins together who were, you know, good, solid Baptist, you know, Bible-believing, bashing Baptist, perfect, you know. I go, okay, we're gonna really trap Kelly this time. And I remember in our condo, I'll never forget, I just got released by the Angels, and I just signed with the New York Yankees. And how about those Yankees? Never made it to the big leagues. I was just stuck in Columbus the whole time. They were pretty decent, too. I was like a 4A player. I wasn't a major leaguer, but I tricked them for 5 years. What the heck? Anyway, so I'm sitting there, and we trap Kelly, and we're going, well, what's the day that you know Christ? She goes, you know, she started crying. She goes, I don't know the day or the hour that I received Christ. All I know is that I remember asking God, you know, and praying to God and going and just telling him how much I love him and I love you, Lord. And I don't know what day and what the hour was. And I go, well, you got to know the day and the hour. You're not a Christian. You're not really truly Christ. You know, you don't know who Christ is if you don't have a day or the hour. And she started crying and she goes, Darrell, I mean, don't you know my heart? Can't you tell that I'm a Christian? I mean, you've known me for 4 years now. Can't you see that Christ is in my heart? Do I really have to have a day? Do I have to have a minute? Do I have to have an hour? And I started crying. I go, no, you don't. I go, I've just been taught that that's what you had to have for you to truly be a Christian. And that day forward, I started thinking, okay, what's going on in her that I don't see? There's something going on that I don't know about. And I felt like, honestly, that I had persecuted the church pretty good. You know, we were evangelical, harvest ministry, this whole Calvary Chapel. You've ever heard of that church? A lot of ex-Catholics. And I was really big in that church and went to a lot of their stuff. And I thought, wow, I really felt like I murdered my wife that day. I didn't kill her with my hands, but I killed her spirit with what I said, with my words. I didn't mean to share that, but it just came to me. But I do remember the part that I did want to share that is more funny. Gotta get off of this. After Mass one Sunday, I brought her up to the priest after Mass, and the priests were always good at our church, but they go to the back and shake hands and go, you know, wasn't that a miserable sermon, you know? Did you enjoy that? No, I'm just kidding. And so we had a young father named Father Albaca, and I said, Kelly, go ask him, why don't we have Bible studies? Why aren't we doing things for the young adults? Why aren't we more active in, you know, Bible teaching? So she goes to the back of the church, and I'm like 10 steps behind her, you know. And so she's talking to the priest, and I'm sitting there going, okay, this is great, because now I think I can get her out of this church, because he's going to go, we don't believe in the Bible. He's going to tell her what's going on. And he goes, praise the Lord. I've been praying that someone like you guys would come and lead a Bible study in our church. We're not interested in leading a Bible study. No. You don't understand, Father. I'm trying to get her out of this church. I'm not trying to come to the... So they hire me to be in ministry, and my wife to lead a young adult ministry and a Bible study at the Catholic Church. Just like, I mean, he trained us for like a month, and I'm going, what the heck is going on? Now I'm leading... I couldn't believe it. I mean, literally just like that. So now we're in ministry. I'm not Catholic. And we have like 40, 50 young adults, and we're teaching young, and we're leading a Bible study. You know, everyone's going, well, you know, well, let's say the Hail Mary. I go, we're not saying the Hail Mary at the end of, you know, we're not, all this stuff that I didn't know about. And so finally, I went to a healing mass. And they had been inviting us to go to a healing mass. And everyone was saying these words like, praise the Lord, God bless you. You know, God is so good. He's done so many great things in my life. I'm like, are you Catholic? Are you guys Catholic? I had never heard that. And the next week, towards the end of my career, now I'm with the Seattle Mariners, and we are in Arizona. So we travel. Kelly comes to meet me. Actually, it's about 3 weeks later. We're in Arizona. Go to a Life Teen Mass. I don't know if you guys ever heard of Life Teen. But, Life Teen International. I didn't know it was a Life Teen Mass. I went to church. And, I remember going into the church. And Kelly had to go to Mass. You know, I go to baseball chapel. Don't need to go to church. But she had to go to Mass. You know, wow, how religious. Okay. But I went with her anyway. We walk into Mass, and people said, hi, how are you? Welcome. How are you? What's your name? I'm Darrell. Wow, well, welcome to our church. I'll be right back. Oh, it says it's a Catholic church. My God, that's amazing. They actually want me to come. Oh, my goodness. They said, welcome. Thanks for being here. My God, that's an amazing thing. And what was even more amazing is when we went to sit down, people didn't like try to trip you as you went by. They actually moved over and let you sit on the outside. They were really nice. What was even more amazing was, you know, the guys who were up playing the guitar and the guys who were singing, and the rest of the church was singing. But they were singing like the songs that they were singing. And they were like singing loud, and they were singing like they wanted to be there. It was so amazing. And I was like, I remember turning to Kelly and go, the Catholic Church, I would become Catholic in a heartbeat. People want to be here. They seem like they really care that I came. They didn't give me a dirty look when I walked in the church and go, what are you doing in my church? Never seen you before. What's going on? I mean, that hospitality kind of warmed my heart. So the next thing you know, this Father Al Baca, and then I'll make this really short because we have a little bit of teaching. We have Ministry Sunday a few weeks later, and they have this RCIA little booth. You know, we have our ministry booths. All the booths are all around like a room like this. And I'll never forget this either. So we're in that corner, and the RCIA booth is like over here. So I just... You know, I said, Kelly, I'm going to go check out the RCI booth just to see what it's all about. And I don't know what I was thinking about. So I was walking over to the RCIA booth, kind of like I got about right there. And then Father Al Baca is over here somewhere, and I see these flowing robes. Praise the Lord! Praise the Lord! He sees me going to the RCIA. You're going to become Catholic. I go, I'm not going to become Catholic, Father. I'm not. I'm just going to see what they got over there. See what it's all about, you know. See if I can mess somebody else up, you know. Oh, I know you're not gonna. I'm not. I'm really not. Oh, I know you're not gonna become Catholic. Praise the Lord anyway. I go. I'm not become Catholic. So, Easter I became Catholic, you know. But it was a difficult process to become Catholic because. You know, all the other information I had to process, you know, and no one really knew my answers from a biblical perspective. Gus did a great job today when he was sharing the scripture. And most Catholics couldn't do what Gus was doing today. You know, you're going like, well, show me in the Bible. They go, well, I don't know where it is, but, you know, here's a Scott Hahn tape, you know. Okay, Scott Hahn, okay. Well, what about, oh, here's a Steve Wood tape. Okay. And so I started listening to this stuff. And I was like, you got to be kidding me. I mean, this scripture that Scott and talk about in John chapter 6, verse 6, if you eat the flesh and drink my blood, in Corinthians, like Gus was saying, Corinthians chapter 10, Corinthians chapter 11, you know, about eating and drinking of the blood of Christ unworthily, if it was just a symbol, how could you drink of a symbol unworthily? Or eat, you know what I'm saying? If there was no power in the Eucharist, why would people be getting sick? I mean, that's powerful stuff. I'm serious. You have no idea what dynamite we're sitting on. I mean, I'm supposed to be telling you to ignite. That tells you to ignite. The scripture blows us up. Are you kidding me? And I tell you what, I was telling Gus earlier, I felt like I had been lied to my whole life. I felt like Saul becoming Paul. I really am telling you the truth. I really felt like a persecutor of the church. And I felt like, matter of fact, I got a chance to go to Rome, and I got to go to where Paul's church is, Paul at the Wall, and I got to repent of persecuting this church. It's kind of, I try to make fun of it now because I feel so bad, but that's why I preach the gospel, because I feel like this gospel, this church, is so full of truth. And a lot of us are sitting there, we're sitting on dynamite and don't even know it. And the last straw was, and I'll never forget, I was sitting there, and I was sitting on the curb in front of the church, St. Angelo Merici, going, oh my God, you know, I don't think I want to become Catholic. And we had a Irish Catholic priest, he came out and he goes, what's going on, Darrell? I go, I don't think I can become Catholic. He goes, well, then don't. I go, Father, you're supposed to talk me into this. I'm not going to talk you into this. If you don't want to become Catholic, then don't become Catholic. Well, what was really going on was when you become Catholic, you're supposed to go to this thing called confession. We talked about it a lot today. And I had sinned. I was 35 years old. I had played in the big leagues. I had sinned. I have sinned. I committed some sins, like big league sins. And I was hoping, when I was laying in my bed at night, that God forgave me. I remember hoping. I remember laying in bed going, God, please, just hoping he forgave me. And what I found out, I was so afraid of actually confessing my sin to another person. If anyone of you have ever sinned, you know what I'm saying, how humiliating it is, and how humbling it is, and how afraid you can be. 35 years, I had sinned. And I remember, I went to confession, I didn't know what to say. I didn't know the act or the, you know, all I knew was I needed to receive the Eucharist. And I needed to know God forgave me. I'll never forget the words when he said, you know, your sins have been forgiven. And I knew that was finally. You know, if you've ever sinned, to know that your sins have been separated from you, it's a big deal. Because sometimes they weigh you down because you don't know. You know, you don't know, but that's why it's such a gift in this church to be able to go and have your sins forgiven. Oh. And I tell you what, I felt like $1 billion. And when I received the Eucharist, I was surprised. I didn't get blown out of the door. I was so shocked. And I bet you that's what happened to the early church, because they really got the Eucharist. They were slain in the Spirit. I guarantee it. I don't have any scriptural support to that, but I bet you they were. And I'm sorry to get emotional, but you know what? What a gift we have in Jesus. Amen. Amen. What a gift we have. I'm 6'2", 220. I could turn around anybody's fastball. I wasn't afraid of anybody. I wasn't afraid of anybody. And I used to wear out Roger Clemens. I used to wear him out. That was before, you know, what could have possibly. But he still threw gas and had a great curveball. I could hit anybody, and I wasn't afraid of any. I remember I led our team in getting hit by a pitch. I'm a man's man, but you know what? I was afraid to confess my sin. I ran over people. They call me Diesel. My nickname's Diesel. I must have run over 10 catchers. I could inflict some pain on folks. But I was so fearful to be separated from God eternally. That scared me to death. I remember we were doing some celebrity football games, basketball games with all these celebrity football players. I'm in with all-pro linebackers, all-pro linemen. These guys are 6'6", 260, like Veed. And we're sitting in the van. I go, wow, you know, well, you guys are so tough. I don't know how you can hit guys like that. And oh, my God, how are you? You guys are Raiders and all. They go, man, I can't believe you got hit by a baseball. I said, hit by a baseball? Are you kidding me? Oh, my God, I remember when I got hit when I was in high school, I quit. You know, I go, you quit because you got hit by a baseball? Are you kidding me? These guys, you're getting 320-pound linemen running a 4-4, and you're worried about a baseball. Fear, you never know, right? So anyway. And I became Catholic for those reasons. And I came a little bit kicking and screaming in the church, but I knew I wanted to receive the Eucharist. I knew I had to receive the Eucharist because I knew it was the body, blood, soul, and divinity of Christ. Unbelievable. Today we're going to talk about two things. Got a little bit of time. We're going to talk about what trips us up. Okay? Gus and Father earlier talked about some things that sometimes trip us up. And Paul had some things that tripped him up. He called it the thorn in the flesh. So in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, you guys turn your Bibles. Why is everybody laughing? You guys got your Bibles, don't you? Absolutely. We're good Catholics. Yeah. All right. Excuse me. Oh, I like that. Verse 7, chapter 12, verse 7. But I refrain lest anyone think more of me than what he sees in me or hears from my lips. Well, let me set the stage real quick before I get too far into this. You know, like I said, I feel like Saul, you know, I'm a little bit like Paul. And Saul was knocked over off the horse as he was going to Damascus. You guys remember, he was the first persecutor of the church. And, you know, they said that, you know, I guess the guy named Ananias was killed. I think that was the guy's name. I'm just drawing a blank, but anyway, I think it was.
Stephen?
Yeah, Stephen. Ananias was his wife. I think they did something. Anyway. Yeah, the money. He lied to Peter. Absolutely. See, I know what I'm talking about. I just have only had 3 hours of sleep, taking a red eye in here. But Stephen was stoned, and so Paul. They said that they laid the cloak of Stephen at the feet of Paul. Well, at Saul. And Saul began breathing murderous threats against the way, as they call it, the early church. So now we've fast forwarded to the book of Corinthians, and now Paul is now called Paul because he's now had a revelation from Christ. He was healed, and now his scales fell from his eyes in Damascus. So now we're looking at a guy probably 10 or 12 years later that has now risen to a huge place in the church, and he's now evangelizing the entire, basically, Gentile church. But what's amazing here is he talks about his thorn in the flesh. His thorn in the flesh, something that's going to keep him humble. Now, none of us probably can relate to that because we don't, as most men would ever tell you, we don't need any help with anything. We don't have any needing help with directions. We don't need any help figuring things out. We can always see the menu just right. I'm actually wearing glasses because I've now started boasting in my weaknesses. So I'm going to fast forward, and he said, that I may not become conceited, I was given a thorn in the flesh, an angel of Satan, to beat me and keep me from getting proud. 3 times I begged the Lord that this might leave me, and he said to me, my grace is sufficient. My grace is enough for you. And so I willingly boast of my weaknesses instead, so the power of Christ may rest on me. Therefore, I am content with weakness. I am content with mistreatment, with distress, with persecutions and difficulties for the sake of Christ. For when I am powerless, it is then that I am strong. And he goes on and talks about being a super apostle and all this other stuff. But I like that scripture because I can relate to it in regards to we all have these battles. We all have these thorns in the flesh. Now, you just remember, a thorn in the flesh is something that, it's a little different than a pain in the fanny, okay? A thorn in the flesh is something that troubles you, that you have consistent problems with. And we heard earlier about, you know, that men struggle with pornography. We struggle with our language. We struggle with the inability to say, I'm sorry. We struggle with those sins that are seen and unseen. We struggle inside. Our main struggle comes from our original sin. Our main struggle comes from the garden. It was talked about earlier about how we struggle with what we do, and we replace who we are with what we do. And that's really the source of most of our struggle, is we don't embrace who God meant us to be. You know, we were created by God, for God, to worship God. You know, Gus talked about earlier how we were created to make sure we get to heaven. And who else gets to heaven if we're married? Our wives, and who else?
Children.
Children, right? And anyone else we meet. You shouldn't even need, thank you, where's that at? Thank you for the invitation for all of us to come and speak. You don't need us. You guys already in your midst have many of us that are waiting to speak out on God's behalf and say, this is my story. I was created by God, for God, to worship God. And this is what he's doing in my life. And these are the struggles I've had. And this is where he's taking me. All of you lead people to Christ, not because of how great you are or how great you were, but who you are in Christ and what he's doing in your life and heart. And it's got nothing to do with religion. You know what? The biggest thing I want to just challenge you on is getting to know your story. Because we all have had something tremendous happen to us. When Gus was sharing about his daughter being at the bottom of the pool, who wasn't visualizing every step of that moment in your heart? I mean, I was sitting there going, oh my God, I have a 13-year-old daughter. Oh my, who hasn't almost had someone get hit by a car? Who hasn't had somebody get hit by a car? Who hasn't had a tough thing happen in your life? Somebody get hit by this kid from modern day high school in California, player of the year in California last year at Arizona State, slide into second base head first, paralyzed. No malicious act, just going to grab the ball, knee hit him in the right place at the right time, going the wrong way. Great kid. So we all have these moments. We all know these people. We all have our own stuff in our lives that are powerful witnesses to those who are longing to hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. And it's got nothing to do with religion. It's about your personal testimony, where you were here, and because of this happened, God brought you to here. Because if God hasn't done anything in your life, you have nothing to say, nothing to share. And I'll tell you, even if you haven't gone through anything, and really, you know what? Some of us haven't. I mean, we haven't had dramatic stories. But you know what? That's enough of a dramatic story. Amen? I mean, it is. The gospel says, once I was lost, and now I'm found. Once I was dead, and now sin no longer has any power over me. I've been changed, I've been redeemed, I've been bought with a price. That's enough. That's enough of a story. But we also have our personal testimony to add to that. But that's enough. And if you and I can't praise God for what he did on the cross, just for that, for dying in our place, because I should be there and so should all of you. I guarantee it. And he died in our place. Therefore, we were created by God, for God, to worship God. And there's so many scriptures that talk about that. And I'm not going to get into all of them. And the last thing I want to talk about is we have a Lenten obligation to change. 40 days and 40 nights to change. God said, the study's been 3 weeks. If you do the same thing for 3 weeks. I love that. 60 seconds? Oh, my God, what a great thing. 60 seconds, that's a great tool, Gus. Is Gus still here? Did he split? No longer aquí, no está. All right, no problem. What a great thing that he brought up. But we have some personal issues. We have some thorns. I do too. We have some personal issues this Lent I really want us to reflect on. I really want us to go where God wants us to go. And those are those places and Father talked about them too. Those places that we sometimes hide. We sometimes hide. And that's where confession comes in. See, all the stuff that we try to hide, God wants us to boast. He wants to hear about it. Where we boast, where we brag, where we proclaim our weaknesses, now allows basically, you know, the covers to be taken off. Okay, here it is. This is it. This is my, right there. That's my scar. That's my thorn. That's what I got. I need your help. I need, you know, hey, this is what I got, guys. That's what I'm doing here. This is my thorn. This is what I did. This is what I got. And thank God now I don't have that anymore. I don't have that problem. Now, because I raised it up, I'm not going to take off my shirt because I don't want you guys to see the six-pack here. But, yeah, uh-huh. Very expensive $29 jacket. The thorn, the places where we hurt the most is where we have to really let God come in and then talk about it. Give it up to your close friend. Now, I'm not talking about casting pearls before swine. Some of those guys that you go, hey, did you know that? You can't believe. You took a 3-2 slider, but the base is loaded. You're such an idiot, you know. No, I'm not talking about those friends, but I'm talking those friends that are intimate, that are closer than a brother, that you can really trust with intimate things, that will hold you up in prayer, that will think about you and pray about you and not gossip about you, that will help you through those things. Those are the guys I'm talking about. And that's why we're here, because iron sharpens iron. Men together, we build each other up. You know, that's why we are meeting today, because us together, we can all be whole together. Because all of us are fallen. All of us struggle. And somebody here has overcome something that you're dealing with. I guarantee it. I guarantee it. Iron sharpens iron. Men, we need men. We need men to hold us accountable, to be our brothers in Christ, to lift us up, to take us to places where God wants to take us. Men, that's why we're here. We need to ignite. We need to blow up. But we can't do it by not telling the truth and covering our wounds and staying quiet. It's really sad that you're going through that. Too bad. Oh, yeah, me too, man. Let me tell you something. 18 years ago, or when somebody's wife and husband, they're struggling, their marriage is struggling. Hey, we went through the same thing. This is what we did. Maybe this can help. Do you understand? Let's be real. But we got to talk. We got to communicate. You got to be real, gentlemen. Because those thorns, if you don't take out the thorns and you don't open up the wound, what happens? It goes bad. It gets infected. And then what happens to an infected wound? It becomes an abscess. And then it takes everything down with it. It's so critical that we really get this short, easy, simple message about thorn in the flesh. Very simple. And the last thing, one more time, I just want to make sure we get it about worshiping God. He deserves your worship. The creator of the universe, are you kidding me? When I was watching what was going on with our poor brothers and sisters in Japan, did it humble you to think about the awesome power? I mean, I'm in California. And, you know, we are earthquake folks. The country that was the most prepared for anything like this to ever happen. And it was absolutely, it wasn't useless, but they couldn't prevent. So do you understand how powerless we are without this guy? My son was telling me, my little 9-year-old was telling me how we found other planets yesterday in the car. I was looking at him and going, yeah, you know, Dad, in the Hubble telescope, and we found another galaxy. You know how many planets? And I go, and I started thinking about it. I go, you got to be kidding me. There's galaxies upon galaxies, upon planets, millions and billions of stars that our God created. Yet he craves an intimate, personal relationship with you and me. And this is how funny God is. This is how intimate he is. This is how he works. Before I even came on, this is the little stupid stuff God just goes, just showing you I'm God. Just my flight gets canceled tonight to go home. I get little text messages, and they put me on a flight tomorrow. I'm going, wow, you know. And I was scheduled to get home, you know, 2 a.m. I probably won't get home. Who knows? But God, you know, he's just messing with us. He wants me to share this. I know that, so it's his whole deal. So then the lady gets on. She goes, oh, we can't get you home. We can't get you home. And then Ed tried to get me home. Couldn't get me home. So all of a sudden, she comes back. She goes, yeah, I found a flight. You're going to go to Philly. You're going to go. So she goes, I go, well, what's the flight stop? She goes, well, you're going to actually get home at LAX at 11:30. I go, wow, 11:30. I was supposed to get home at 1:30 in the morning. And I go, God, you're so funny. You just hooked me up. You know, he had a little fist bump. I said, I couldn't believe it. So I went from not going home at all. You guys were going, that's no big deal, Darrell. Come on, are you kidding me? Well, yeah, it is a big deal. When I spend nights and nights away from my family, and I want to be home and be able to wake up with them and go to church with my kids and my family in the morning. Yeah, it's a big deal to me, you know. And that's how God is. He just honors you. Because he knew, I was sitting there going, oh man, how am I going to call my kids and tell them I can't go to church with them in the morning? And I'm trying to figure out how I'm going to, and I wasn't going to get there. You know, that's how God is. The littlest stuff. You know, the Bible talks about the sparrow. He knows the hairs on your head. Even my head. And some of you guys' head. He's intimately concerned. And yet, hundreds of billions of stars in the universe and all the things he's got going on, he's got that under control too. Isn't that awesome? I mean, if you really can, some of you guys are pretty smart, smarter than me. If you get that, you go, my God, that's pretty amazing. It couldn't be. So, therefore, I finish with a challenge. And guys, it's time for us to be men. Some of us look like men. Some of us are big men. Some of us are skinny men. Some of us are strong men, and some of us are slender men. Some of us have more hair, some of us have less hair. But God calls us to be men. Men. And sometimes I've been accused as being an athlete, you know. Remember baseball, have you ever heard them say, baseball is a what game? Child's game. It's a kid's game. Played by a bunch of kids. You know, and we worship all those guys that are, you know, what about A-Rod and what about Jeter and, you know, those guys are something else. Oh, my God. You know, and I just want to tell you, we have to start to be men. Because if we're worshiping all that stuff, as much as I love the fact that I'm here because probably I played a little bit of ball, the bottom line is, if we don't worship God, we're going to worship something. That's why we love cars and boats and houses and Mercedes and Porsches and all that stuff. If you don't worship God, if you don't value God, then you're going to worship something. You are created by God to worship. It's time for us to become men and worship God. And I'm going to finish right here. Paul in 1 Corinthians chapter 13. Who's been married? Has anyone ever heard the 1 Corinthians chapter 13? It's a love, right? Right? At the end of chapter 13, we call it the love verse, the love chapter. It's a chapter of love. But you know what it really is? You know what that scripture really is? It's a rebuke. It's basically telling us, you know, we seek these things, and the best gift is love. But we look for all these other things. Love never fails. Prophecy will cease. Tongues will be silent. Knowledge will pass away. Our knowledge is imperfect, and prophesying is imperfect. When the perfect comes, the imperfect will pass away. Because when I was a child, I used to talk like a child. I used to think like a child. I used to reason like a child. But when I became a man, I put childish ways aside. Now we see indistinctly, almost like we're in a mirror, too close. My knowledge today, your knowledge today is imperfect. But one day, I will be known even as I'm known by my Lord and Savior. And these are the real things in Christ: faith, hope, and love. And the greatest of these is love. Because when I was a child, I used to talk like a child. I used to think like a child. I used to even reason like a child. But when I became a man, I put away childish things. It's time for us to become men. Men in our houses. Men at our work. Men in our church. It's time for us to become men so we take over this world. We are the gospel. We are the body of Christ. My challenge to me and to you is, let's be men. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. God bless you.